Hello, good evening viewers. Today let us learn about the Bluetooth technology. Okay, Bluetooth is one of the widely used wireless communication technology like Wi-Fi, infrared and all. So as we have seen in the last video, same as Wi-Fi, Bluetooth also operates in ISM band, that is 2.4 to 2.485 gigahertz, and this is used in many devices like mobiles, telephones, computers, desktops, to share files, to make share the files and all applications, right? So Bluetooth was initially used or first invented by the Ericsson company in 1994, and they found it to replace the RS-232 cables, which was wired to transfer. They invented it for the transmission of the data without wire, that is wireless transmission initially. The name Bluetooth was again coined by the Ericsson company, and it was coined in the on behalf of a king named Harald Bluetooth, right? It was the Bluetooth was coined in the name of Harald Bluetooth, and he integrated Denmark and Norway, two countries together. So in the credit of that, people have given the name as Bluetooth. So Bluetooth standard is presently maintained by Bluetooth SIG group, that is special interest group. You can see here special interest group, which was has under the special interest group of world, total 30,000 companies are registered on this special interest group, and they all come together and create this standard, set the standard. Presently we are into the version of Bluetooth 4, but in this context, according to syllabus, we are discussing about Bluetooth 2 and 3. So initially Bluetooth standard was maintained by IEEE standard, that is IEEE 802.15.1, but presently it no longer maintains. It is standardized and it is maintained by IEEE 802.15, right? And Bluetooth is a ad hoc network. That means what? There is no centralized access point required. At any instant of time, any two devices can create an hotspot, create an network, and established a Bluetooth communication. It is called as an ad hoc network, right? Here usually we use half duplex method in this one, and there are around 1600 hops per second can be achieved. It uses a FHSS, that is frequency hopping spectrum. We'll discuss later. Presently this Bluetooth 1.2 and Bluetooth version 2, they supports respectively 1 Mbps and 2 Mbps data rate, but we are in the rate, we are in Bluetooth 4, which supports very high data rate up to 10 Mbps speed. And as if you know that Bluetooth applications are a lot, and you can use it for file transmission from one mobile to another, or computer to another computer, or any device to another. It is also used for, as best example is your Bluetooth earphones and headsets used, and it is also used for controlling, like it is used for a Bluetooth mouse and Bluetooth keyboards. It is also used in Bluetooth printers are also there. Many applications are there. It is used, one of the technology was coined, that is OBEX, that is object exchange, was used for transferring the files. Again, it is a standard of Bluetooth only. And we can create a network of Bluetooth devices, and at a time we can send multiple data transmission over the devices. It can be done. So there are lots of applications of Bluetooth. Do many things. Right, now let us see about the architecture of the Bluetooth. So architecture of the Bluetooth is divided into two things, that is PicoNet and ScatterNet. So PicoNet is one of the small network. PicoNet means a small network, that is within the day-to-day life, whatever we use Bluetooth applications, so they fall under PicoNet. For example, you can see this diagram. In this PicoNet, what people will can do is there will be one primary device from which Bluetooth is enabled, and it becomes a master, and for that Bluetooth many other device can be connected, right? as of now in PicoNet, what it defines that there can be a total of 8 devices. In one device will be the primary and master, and other 7 devices will be the slaves. Okay, and always the master is the one which creates the connection, Bluetooth, establish the Bluetooth connection. Okay, so totally as of now there can be only 7 devices which can be active, and the range of communication from this master to slave, the distance will be 10 meters. And also you can see that at a time the Bluetooth configuration, that is a pairing, can be Bluetooth pairing can be achieved up to 255 devices, but only at a time only 7 hosts or 7 slaves can be connected to a primary, remaining all should be in a parking state, that is idle state. So whenever other device wants to do the communication, then it has to get activated, then but it and others should get back into the sleep mode. That means at a time maximum 7 devices can be connected using a Bluetooth device. That is a thing about this PicoNet, only 8 devices. But ScatterNet provides an extension of this one, where multiple PicoNets can be connected together. You can see this diagram with this PicoNet is in this one there is one primary Bluetooth device which has 3 devices or secondary device connected. Another PicoNet device, there is only one device connected. You can see an intermediate node which is a primary node again. It can become primary and secondary alternatively. This becomes a bridge for this two PicoNet. So ScatterNet is the one where multiple PicoNets can be connected together. A device from a primary connects to the primary of the another PicoNet using an intermediate primary device. So device from one of the PicoNet can send the data to another PicoNet's device using this connection. So this becomes a ScatterNet. Okay, two architectures are there, PicoNet and ScatterNet. Now let us see about the Bluetooth devices. So Bluetooth devices, as we seen, it operates in 2.4 GHz band. In last diagram, last class, we have seen this frequency band, right? And data rate supported is 1 Mbps. Then how it is supported, we'll see at the end, right? And one more speciality of this Bluetooth is the Bluetooth can be connected with the Wi-Fi, that is IEEE 802.11b Wi-Fi standard. This can be paired with the Bluetooth, so that Bluetooth data can be directly shared with the Wi-Fi data. It's one of the very good advantage. So here you can see the protocol stack of a Bluetooth layer. Okay, as you see the OSI model, 7-layer model, it is similar to that one. And bottom we have physical layer, then we have data link layer, and we have middle layer and application layer. Many layers are merged together. It is not exactly same as the OSI model, it is slightly different. In this layer, what we can see is in physical layer we come across physical radio and baseband layer. In data link layer we come across logical link control adaptation protocol, that is L2CAP. Once again I repeat, logical link control adaptation protocol. This one of the important protocol. Along with this protocol we have some other supportive protocol, control protocols, other LLC protocols, RF communication protocols, service recovery protocols fall under this middle layer. Finally, this top one is application layer. Like Bluetooth, in a Bluetooth we can send the files. That is, we can be audio file, video file, text file, anything. There are different applications. Again, in Bluetooth, we will be playing games, online games using Bluetooth. That is a different application. Sometimes we can make a calls using Bluetooth. That is a different application. Right? Sometimes we'll be hearing, controlling a device like mouse and speakers, earphones using Bluetooth. So these are all the different application, and each application's data should be handled carefully. So this logical link control adaptation protocol takes care of this application data management, will be taken care by this L2CAP layer. We'll see this one in detail, right? We'll see this the logic link control adaptation protocol does a few of the specific functions. That is, one of the function is multiplexing, segmentation and reassembly, quality of service management, then group management. We'll see them one by one. Okay, this L2 cap layer, this is mainly responsible for handling the data from higher layers to bottom layer. That is, for this one, higher layer is application layer. It handles the layer data from many service and other application layers and supports give a service to the baseband. That is, delivers to the baseband, right? So we can think of two things. One is it supports multiplexing. Okay, so in this one we can see this the data packet format. In this one we have two bytes of length, 2 bytes of channel ID, and around 65,535 bytes of data and control. You can see that its length will be indicating the length of this complete frame, and this channel ID will be indicating the channel in which the data communication is taking place. We'll discuss what is a channel. Then data indicates the amount of the data being transferred. Either it can be of data or control data or control signal. The length can be of 16 bit, and the 2 to the power of 16 will be the data that can be sent over this layer. And channel ID, you can see CID, channel ID indicates the which virtual channel is created being used. We'll see what channel ID later, right? Then this L2 cap supports the multiplexing. That means the data coming from higher layers will be from different application. Like it can be supporting a audio being played in a speaker and a mouse being controlling, and there may be a file transmission. All the applications will be coming together, and all of them will be multiplexed together, and they are delivered to the baseband layer. Okay, first it supports this multiplexing. In sender side it does the multiplexing, and in receiver side it does a reverse operation. Like in transport layer, in this OSI model does this same function. It collects data from different applications and multiplexes and delivers to the bottom layer. And in reverse order, it takes out the data of each application and demultiplexes and delivers back to the applications. And segmentation and reassembly. Here you can see that this L2 cap layer supports a data of huge data, that is up to 65,535 bytes, whereas this baseband layer supports only data of 343 bytes. So very small size which is compared. Therefore, if we get a huge data of 65,535 bytes, then it has to be divided into small packets. So it supports this segmentation, divides this into small packets, each one will be of 345 bytes. But out of this 343 bytes, 4 bytes will be consumed for the defining the packet length. Therefore, subtracting these 4 bytes, we'll get 339 bytes. At a time, we can send 339 bytes over a single baseband channel. Therefore, this supports the segmentation and reassembly. And in at the receiver side, all these small packets has to be reassembled and delivered back to the L2 cap layer. So about quality of service, this supports a best effort service and also the connection oriented service. So this can be defined by this quality service management. If you want a good quality, then connection oriented service is used, and if you no quality service, will be always best effort service. So best of service means if there are any losses in the packets, then they are not retransmitted, they'll be discarded. Next, it also supports a group management. That means at a time there can be a multiple devices connected to there. That as we have discussed, for a single primary user there can be 7 secondary users connected at a time. We can broadcast data to all the 7 devices. So that management is also taken care by this L2 cap layer. Okay, so these are all the functions of the L2 cap layer. Now let us move on to the baseband layer. So baseband layer is as if equivalent to your MAC layer. So MAC layer, it will be assigning first addresses, then it's also responsible for error control and error controls and flow controls. The same functions are done here also in the baseband layer. So this method makes use of a TDMA, that is time division multiple access. That means each user will be sharing some time for sending the data, Here we should see one diagram first, then we'll discuss. So in this one you can see that there is a time sharing. That means we will be having one slot. One slot will be of 625 milliseconds. And so in one slot, one frequency will be used. So again in the next slot, the time duration will be 625. So each slot will be busy with only one user. Means one slot is used for communicating one user at a time. So other slot will be in non-communicating mode. Right, this is a time division multiplexing. Means at a time, one slot will be used by one user and remaining all will be in idle state. So again in the next time, next slot will be shared by another user. So this is a time division multiplexing method which is used in here. Okay, along this with this time division multiplexing, it is responsible for error correction, data whitening. So data whitening is one of the method which is used for scrambling the data. That means if there should not be any hacking of the data while we are using Bluetooth, is one of the security method which is used. The data will be scrambled randomly so that people cannot rearrange that data, if even though they are able to access the data. It's one of the security method used. It is also responsible for hop selection. What is this hop selection? We'll discuss later. So this hop selection will be the frequency selection. We'll discuss at the end. Then it is also responsible for securities of the Bluetooth baseband. Next, move on in detail about this TDMA. So time division multiplexing method, this can be of a single secondary communication or it can be of multiple secondary communication. You'll see them one by one. So if it is a single secondary communication, that means what? In single secondary communication, there will be one user, the secondary user, and there will be one primary user. The data communication will be from only one primary to one secondary device. That is single secondary communication. So as we have seen, the time slots are divided into 625 microseconds. Primary slots will be assigned for even slots will be assigned for primary user and odd slots will be assigned for secondary user. You can see here, if I take this as a slot number 0, okay, and it is operating in frequency 0. So this is a frequency hopping method. If you observe clearly here, here F0 is one frequency, you can assume 1 megahertz, that is 2403 is the frequency here. Next will be, you can think of 2405. Next you can think of 2015. We jump from one frequency to another frequency. That is called as frequency hopping spectrum method is used in the physical layer here. And also along with this one, time slot is here. That is 625 is a time slot which is used by this frequency F0. And another next 625 use the time slot that is used by this frequency F1. Like along with frequency hopping, the time slots are shared for different users. You can see here it's a 0 and a frequency time slot that is 2 and time slot 4 next. Like even numbers will be used for primaries communication, data will be sent from primary to secondary. And odd numbers, that is 1, time slot 1 and time slot 3. Odd numbers will be shared for the data communication of the secondary user. As we have seen, only one user is there. Even numbers are used by primary, odd numbers are used by secondary. If primary sends the data, then secondary will acknowledge. Along with the acknowledgement, it can send the data. Okay. So you can see here, there are the total time duration, we can call it as also dwell time. And slot time, it is 625 milliseconds, whereas in this one effective data communication takes place with only 366 milliseconds. The remaining time will be utilized for data to reach from primary to secondary. That is called as hopping. So this hopping means the data should come and reach from primary to secondary. That hop time for 10 meters will be around 295 milliseconds will be there. And this will be used for hopping. Effectively, data transmission will be of only 366 milliseconds. This is a case for single secondary communication. When we come for multi-secondary communication, so this will be will be a like a broadcast case or two or three devices connected to one primary user. And in this case, you can see there are two secondary users connected to one primary user, right? So primary will be using always the even numbers. So slot 0 is used by primary. In this case, primary is communicating with secondary 1, so it sends the data in that slot. And the very next slot will be used by that same secondary node, that is slot number 1 will be used to reply back to the primary. And again, next even number can be used by the primary to send data to any other secondary node, that is here secondary 2, data is sent to secondary 2. And the very next odd number slot will be used by the secondary which was scanned by this primary, that will reply back to the primary. That means what? In even numbers, primary will decide to which secondary node it wants to communicate, and the very next odd number will be used by the secondary node, which will reply back to the hop. So like that, we can have multiple secondary nodes can be transmitting the data to primary. And also you can see here that when one of the secondary is communicating with the primary, and that slot is busy with the secondary, other secondary should be in idle state or off state. When another secondary is using, remaining all secondaries are in off state. At a time, only one secondary will be communicating with the primary node. Okay, and the types of links that can be established here are divided into two. That is, one is SCO, that stands for synchronous connection oriented link. Another is ACL, that is asynchronous connectionless link. We'll see what it is. So in case if you want to send a data in which we are more worried about the time delay of the data rather than the loss of the data, right? So for example, here which we can give is the audio call. If you are worried about an audio call using Bluetooth, we will be bothered about the time delay of the delivery. That means when we are speaking, the delay of the delivery should be very, very less. That is fast responsive channel. So in this case, even though some packets in the audio drops also, then it leads to some of the disturbance and it will not completely fail the complete communication. Therefore, we are worried more about the delay, time delay of the delivery rather than the data integrity. So such applications will go for this SCO, synchronous connection oriented. In this one, there will be a logical connection established between a primary and secondary, and once this is done, then there will be, even though in case of any data is not delivered or it is in error, then it is not retransmitted. It will be never retransmitted. So we are more worried about the connection proper connection requirement here, right? In this one, you can see application is a digitized radio communication of 64 kbps speed. In case of an asynchronous connectionless link ACL, in this one you can see that here we will be taking an example of a file transmission. In case of a file transmission, the data should be completely delivered without any error or corruption. Therefore, we are more worried about the data integrity rather than the delay in the transmission. Even though there is more delay in the delivering the data, then there are no issues. Such cases, if an error occurs, then all the errors will be retransmitted, those packets will be retransmitted until we get a complete data. So this gives us a best service. So in this case, we can create two or more slots, and we can achieve up to 725 kbps speed using ACL communication. Now let us move on to the frame format. So in this frame format, as we have seen, a time slot will be of 625 microseconds. There is one mistake. In the previous diagram, you can check out it was in milliseconds, but actually it is in microseconds. This is the correct one, microseconds, right? So this time slot can be combined together. If the communication takes place using only one time slot, or communication also can take place using multiple slots, that is three time slots are being used by only one user, or there can be five time slots being used by one user. When we increase number of time slots for a user, then its data transmission speed will increase. So how it increases, we'll see here one by one. In this one, you can see the time slot is of 625 microseconds. As we have seen, there will be 259 microseconds are need for hopping, and only 366 microseconds will be used for data transmission. This total period of a slot is 625. In this, we subtract the hopping period, that is 259 microseconds. We are left with 366 microseconds effective data transmission. Right? This, what does this hopping means? The time taken to deliver from source to destination along with some control signals being exchanged. Right? That we subtract when we select one frequency for hopping. So in this one, if we subtract this one, then we are getting 336 microseconds. So effectively, when we are using a 1 MHz bandwidth for a 1 MHz bandwidth in one frequency, then if we assume one bit is transmitted in 1 Hz, then we get a maximum of 1 MHz. But actually, it depends upon slot time. As we are getting 366 microsecond, then we will be getting only 366 bits which are being effectively transmitted. That means what? At one slot of time, we can send 366 bits of data. Similarly, if we go for a 3 slot, what is the advantage is all the 3 slots will be assigned for one user for transmission or reception. In this case, hopping time, that is data delivery time, will be at a time. At a time, all the 3 will be sent. Therefore, it uses only, even though it is 3, only one time 259 microseconds is used for hopping. Therefore, if you multiply this 625 into 3, that is for 3 slot, in this one, only one time hopping will take place. That is 250, we subtract 259. Then total effective will be get 1616 microseconds. That is equivalent to 1616 bits being transmitted. Similarly, if we go for a 5 slot period, all the 5 slots will be used by one user. Hopping will be only once. Therefore, 259 bits are used for hopping. So 5 into 625 minus 259 will get 2866 bits using 5 slot. If we use a 5 slots assigned for one user, we can send 2866 bits at one time slot, that is within 625 microseconds. So what is the frame format for this slots? We'll see here. Frame format will be like this. In this one, first is of 72 bits access code, then 54 bits header, then 0 to n bits of payload. So in this header, it is 54 bits because we are discussing it for a three slot data transmission. Okay, in this one, access code is used for the synchronization purpose. Initially, until in synchronize is established, there will not be any communication. Therefore, this out of the 72 bits synchronization bits are used. Also, along with this one, you can think of at a time there will be multiple Bluetooth communications. That means multiple users will be sending, creating their own network and sharing the data to differentiate the devices connected to different Bluetooths. That is again controlled by this access codes. So each Bluetooth primary will has its own different access code, so that there will be a particular differentiation between these picoNets. Now in this one, header is of 54 bit. Why? Because total for one slot we require 18 bits. 18 into 3 will get 54 bits field header for 3 slot. So in case if it is a 5, then it will be 18 into 5. Okay. So we'll see them in detail. So in this header, we have again address type FAS and HEC. We'll see them in detail here. Address will be of 3 bits. So 2 to the power of 3 will get 8. That means 1 to 7. As we have, there are 7 secondary users connected to one primary. Then accessing the each different secondary with different address can be achieved by this 3 bits, right? Like 001 will be used for first user, 002 is used for second user, like that. Then if we go for a zero, all the zeros are there, then it will be a broadcast one. 4 bits type is there. The type of the data can be of a broadcast, or sometimes it can be a control signal or management signal or data signal which is being transmitted. So that is decided by this type of the signal which is being sent. Then the next field is F. F stands for fragmentation. If it is set, then we have to go for a fragmentation. If it is zero, then no need of fragmentation. That means fragmentation directly depends upon the buffer of the receiver. If the buffer is full, then the sender should divide its packets and send. That is controlled by this bit fragmentation bit. Then A is the bit which is used for acknowledgement. Once the data is delivered successfully, received successfully, acknowledgement is sent back. So that is acknowledgement. If it is 1, then acknowledgement will be received. So by default, Bluetooth makes use of a stop and wait protocol in its data link communication protocol, right? And another one is S is the one which is used for sequence number. As we have seen in stop and wait protocol, sequence number will solve the problem of duplication. That is, a pin sequence number can be either 0 or 1. So 0 or 1 sequence number is used in stop and wait protocol to stop the duplications. Right. Last field is HEC. HEC stands for header error correction subfield. You can check that not only for the along with complete data, there will be a CRC or checksum. Only this HEC is for the error correction checksum for only header. So if any errors are there in the header, that is corrected or checked using this HEC. That you can see here, only this is for header, not for complete data. So again, HEC of 8 bit. So here we check, as we are having 3 slots, of all the 3 slots bits are same, then there will be a communication. So or else then we'll take some other decision based on the majority of the identities. Okay, so HEC is used for error checksums. And finally, payload, that is 0 to 2740 bits can be transmitted over this payload. Right, this is about the baseband transmission which we have seen. Now let us move on to the last bottom layer, that is radio layer, that is complete the physical layer. So in this physical layer, let me show you some of the images here. You can see here, this is the frequency band bands of Bluetooth, that is 2.4 gigahertz, 2.40 to 2.48. Yesterday we have seen the same frequencies, ISM band, which is also being used by IEEE 802.11 Wi-Fi standard. But here you can see, previously in Wi-Fi there are only 14 channels, but here we can see there are 79 channels in the same band, right? So in this one, each band is separation of 1 megahertz, that is the each band will be incremented by 1 megahertz. And you can see here there are green color, they are all guard bands, they are not used for communication. Again, you can see here the red color ones, they are used for broadcasting, means if you want to send a broadcast signal, then they are used, right? Remaining all the channels which will be used, that means as we said, we make use of a frequency hopping method. That means what? At a time, one frequency will be used in one slot and remaining all will be idle, and very next time frequency hopping will be shifted to another frequency. For assume that presently we are operating 2.41 gigahertz in one time slot, that is 620 microsecond data is sent. The next can be directly jumped to some other 2.47 gigahertz. So again, next time slot, again frequency will change 2.45 gigahertz. Like this, frequency will be hopping one to one. In 1 second, there will be 1600 hops of the frequency. Okay, we'll not be using all the frequencies at time. At one time, only one frequency in all these frequencies will be used. That is called as one slot. So this frequency hopping method is used. You can see this diagram, this is the time and this is the frequency. So in one time we are operating in one frequency, again we jump to next frequency, again we jump to next frequency randomly, random frequency jumping. So at each time slot we will be operating in only one time slot, one frequency at one time slot. This is the frequency hopping method. So this radio layer, physical layer, again makes use of the frequency hopping spread spectrum, and it operates in 2.4 gigahertz ISM band. Total we have 79 channels of each 1 megahertz, right? So as I discussed, totally there will be 1600 hops per second. If we divide one divided by 1600, then we'll get 625 microseconds. That means one time slot will be of 625 microseconds, as you have seen it previously. Then next, modulation techniques used in this one will be GFSK, that is frequency shift keying with Gaussian bandwidth filtering. Okay, so what it is, we'll see here. So this is the GFSK. Means in this one, if the modulation is based on, if it is logic 1, then you can see data signal, this is carrier signal, and this is a modulated signal. So if logic 1, then carrier frequency in modulated signal, the frequency will be increased than this carrier signal. This is low frequency compared with this one. If it is logic 0, then carrier frequencies, the modulated signal's frequency will be reduced back compared with the carrier signal. So logic 1, its frequency increases from compared with the carrier, it is increased. In logic 0, compared with carrier, the frequency is decreased. You can see this is increased frequency compared to this, whereas this is decreased frequency compared to this. This is a Gaussian based FSK. So in this one, the frequency will be either shifted up if it is positive, shifted low if it is 0. And also you can see how the frequency will be selected. So carrier frequency will be always starts with 2.4 gigahertz, that is 2402 megahertz. For this one, we go on adding the channels, that is 79 channels. Here n stands from 0 to 79. There are, we go on adding the frequencies. So randomly this n will be changed between 0 to 78 randomly, therefore we achieve the frequency hopping in this one. So this completes your Bluetooth communication. Thank you for watching.